really good arrangement with the church and one salvation. So we need to hear that, right? So I guess if I start now, I'll be the universal. Yeah, that would be great. It would be nice. We should have signs. Everybody wants to talk, that's good.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to this old church. Our announcements today are found in your bulletin, but we'd just like to call your attention to a few of them. We have the Fall Festival, which is in 2 weeks. And then we have the trash bag collection of all the plastic bags that you can get. We have, as of this time, 14 pounds of plastic. And that's in, what, 2 weeks' time?
One week, Diana says.
So see how fast it goes? So save all of your plastic bags. And just bring them to the church or the thrift shop on Thursdays. And I believe Lynn has some information, because I will get it all tangled up. The Monday Women's Study Group has been meeting in people's homes in the afternoon on Mondays. This group has been going for about 20 years or so. I remember Kevin Dill's wife being involved, and it had started well before that. It's not a circle. It's a small group of people who get together. We share some kind of lesson, and we spend time in prayer for our own concerns and for the congregation. We wanted to change to evening because we had heard there were a few people who might want to come out in the evening who were not available in the daytime. So we made plans to start in the evening, beginning with October 16th, Monday, in the pastor's office. Unfortunately, I didn't take people's schedules into account when we made this decision, and I screwed up royally, so we will meet on the 16th at 6:30 in the evening, just in case someone shows up then. But after that, we will go back to alternate afternoons, alternate Monday afternoons, still in the pastor's office at 1 o'clock, until the new year begins, and then things should smooth out, and we'll give the evening a try. If we can get some new members, lovely. So we welcome you to come out, give it a go, but remember, it will be at 1 o'clock, not at 6:30 p.m., as I had been telling everybody. Sorry about that. Thanks, Lynn. John is up here to tell us a little bit about stewardship and Commitment Sunday.
Ooh.
Now that comes
Ooh.
Later.
Ooh. This is where everybody usually goes, oh gosh. Stewardship. Stewardship Sunday is going to be Sunday, the 12th of November. But we are kicking off stewardship starting today. Everyone will be getting our stewardship letter this week. They should be going out tomorrow. So please look for that with the form to fill out for your pledges for next year. It's very important that we, especially as we become smaller as a church, which we'd all like to see that not happen, but it's important that we continue to contribute to our church family and this church organization, because it takes into account the daily running of this congregation. In every way, we can't function without your help, and not only financially. We always talk about talents and treasures and time. We would actually prefer to have more people contribute their time and their talents, but it does become necessary, as you all know, and you've all been here forever, and we need to continue to support the efforts of everything that we do in this church, especially think about what's going to hopefully happen relatively, we hope soon, when we have the call of a new pastor. Just so you know, the last several years, we're running at a deficit, and that's not unusual, but we run at a deficit, and it's relatively workable. But we haven't had a full-time pastor in this church since 2017. Pastor Debbie left here in 2017, and we had 3 years with Pastor Joel. And with Pastor Joel, we only paid for half of the pastoral responsibility. Covenant took care of the other half. So when we call a new pastor, it's going to fall on us. And I just ask everybody to kind of consider that, because we are hoping that, God willing, any day now, we will be able to make a determination on a pastor head of staff for this church, and hopefully that will help an awful lot with our attendance every week and getting more of our members back into the building. But it's something that's going to affect our budget in a very big way. And we budget for it anyway, because it has to be budgeted. So please consider that the stewardship forms are due back by the 12th, if at all possible. And the presbytery has maintained the amount that we give for per capita. It's at $37 again next year, and that's for the 17th year in a row. So that hasn't changed, and that would be in addition to anything. Our church will pay the entire amount up front, because it's cheaper for us to do it that way than to pay it over time. But that's over $5,000 that we have to put into that, to the presbytery, for membership to the presbytery. So please keep that in mind, and we certainly appreciate everything that everybody does to help keep our church family going every single week.
Just one last word. Pastor Deb, I heard from yesterday, and she is overjoyed at finally getting the bulletin and all of the information about all of us. So she wants to keep in touch and know what's going on. So just a shout out to Deb, because she just might be watching today. Okay, enjoy.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Please join me as we share together in the responsive call to worship. How beautiful are the places where you dwell, O Lord.
This house cannot contain your glory. Even the heavens are bursting with the goodness of your presence.
Happy are those who find their strength in you.
Hear our prayers.
Now for a wonderful, rousing, good morning, praise the Lord hymn on page 130.
Is of love, God and King, the triumphs of his grace. be seated. It's a privilege, as a Presbyterian, as a follower of Reformed theology, to come to a time of confession of sins. Let us join together in the prayer of confession. Holy God, giver of blessings, we thank you for the mercies we know and ask your forgiveness when we fail to acknowledge you as the source of all good. When we hoard your gifts, when we say, that's mine, when we ignore the bounty around us, when we are blind to the good, forgive us. Help us to share, to see, to live gratefully. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Be seated. If it is a privilege to practice Reformed theology in this lovely and wonderful church, it is just as much a privilege to be able to give of our time and especially today, now, our talents. Let us demonstrate our gratitude by bringing to God our tithes and our offerings.
Dear God, may our gifts help feed the hungry, give shelter to the homeless, and help all those who need your help. May they help us spread your love, O God, to those who need you day by day. Amen. Now comes the time we all look forward to so we can catch up on each other's news, joys, and sorrows and concerns. What are your prayers for this day?
I just want to have a wonderful joy of just being here today. I want to thank everyone for their prayers, for their calls, for their cards, for everything. Thanks so very much. I'm getting there. I'm almost better.
I have a new granddaughter, a great-granddaughter that's Johnny and Dave's granddaughter, and her name is Molly, and she's quite a gal already. She's made a big entrance to this world and made a lot of people worry, and I bet you we're going to worry the rest of her life every little bit. But thank you. It was a good thing to have.
I'd like to ask prayers for a friend, Dorothy. She lost her husband this week. And for her daughters, Nancy and Colleen. They're all very close family and dear friends of my mother.
Hey, Joy. You've been seeing my brother's name in the bulletin for some time, and I want to thank you for your prayers. He's the sheep guy. Many of you have visited his farm and are on first-name basis with his sheep. He has been battling cancer. He's had some very serious surgery over at Penn this week. I talked to him yesterday. He looks like you know what, but he is up and walking around, and we're looking forward to a long and productive life. Thank you.
I just want to thank the Lord for the blessings of his care. My son and his partner had a baby, and they had a very dramatic birthing session. And you know, at one point, she thought she was going to die. But the Lord was there, and he was strong. And everybody is happy and healthy, and they're coming home today. And just it's a wonderful thing. And then also, thank you for blessings for my mom, who had a trip to the emergency room on Thursday night, and everything worked out fine, and she's back and trying some new medications, but the Lord was with her, and she is strong, and just thank you for everyone's prayers and concerns.
I'd just like to say how happy I am that my wife, Maria, and our friend of over 25 years, Louise, who we met in Amsterdam, who's now living in Canada, is here today. We're all going to be taking a trip up to Massachusetts starting on Tuesday, so I guess prayers for a safe return and a good time while we're there.
Yes, I have a couple of prayers here. First of all, one of our Burlington entertainers, Sabra, who was here 2 weeks ago, her husband passed away last week, Ron, so prayers for Sabra and her family. Also, another Burlington entertainer, Tim and Lynn. Lynn has been battling a lot of issues. She's a stroke victim, and then last summer she had surgery for lung cancer, and she was getting over that and doing really well. And then she fell and she broke her hip, And she was in rehab, and she was doing well, and then she got COVID. So she's home now, and she's on the mend, but prayers for for both Lynn and her husband, Tim, who are going through a lot right now. Okay, thanks.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we know that in good times and in bad times, in trying times and in joyful times, you are with us, walking with us, helping us, supporting us, giving us hope. Hear our prayers for the people that have been mentioned. The joy of having Georgie back in her seat. The joy of Sally not being so ill at all and back in her seat. The great joy of a granddaughter and great-granddaughter to that family. We praise you and thank you for those wonderful blessings. At the same time, we know there are others who are grieving for the loss of a husband and a father, grieving for injuries sustained, grieving for cancer that one lives in fear of returning. We thank you that we can look to you for hope and encouragement and pray that you will, in fact, bless us abundantly with that hope. We thank you for a new baby. What a wonderful thing to cheer us all. But in addition to wonders and joys, such as Alex and Maria having a friend visit from Canada and having a son heal to watch over his sheep. In addition to those things, we bring before you really big things. We praise you that we have not suffered from an earthquake during which over 2,000 people have died in Afghanistan. We praise you and thank you that we are not on the front lines of a war against oppression in Ukraine. We praise and thank you that at this moment we are here in beautiful Riverton, and not in Israel, where the people are living in dread. We recognize that there are great divisions within our country. We ask that you would heal those divisions. Help us to understand our great privileges and the great blessings we have in this country. Help us to know and appreciate and understand and feel pity but hope at the same time for those who do not have the privileges that we do have. We thank you for the members of this congregation, so steady, so enthusiastic, so willing to give of their time and their talents, which we will see in just a few moments. It is an abundantly blessed church. We ask you to please heal any hatred we have in our hearts at this moment, to think only with kindness of our friends and our relatives, and of also the people that we don't care for. We pray that you will help us find a clear pathway to understanding and their thoughts and their hatred. Heal them, heal all of us of every hatred we harbor within our hearts. For we know that your model and the model of the Christ we worship is the model we should aspire to. Help us to do that even better this week than last week, and even more so the week following that. We ask these things in Christ's name, who taught us to pray reverentially, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive the debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you will have a little pity for me, because it's been a long time since I've been in the pulpit, and I think I spent more time picking these three scriptures, could have written two or three sermons a few years ago in the same time I picked the scriptures. The first one is purely for me. It has really not so much to do with the topic of the day, but it is one of my favorites, and I absolutely love this scripture from Deuteronomy. And I also would like to say that the way I do things, I always like to have a psalm, which we usually get in the beginning, and something from the Old Testament, something from the New Testament, and heaven forbid that we should forget Paul and not have something from the epistles. So, you are going to be treated to three readings. We already covered the psalm at the beginning. From Deuteronomy 30, 15 through 19. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that your Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And now the gospel from Matthew chapter 6. Verses 24 through 34. This one is more to the point for today. No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you by worrying add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon, in all his glory, was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, Will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who strive for all these things. And indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today. And from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 9 through 11. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation. Never let it be said that Paul is not a little bit arrogant. I laid a foundation, said Paul, and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. And now I think we have a treat in store.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to this episode of This Old Church. So today, Storm and I are going to be talking to you about remodeling and building, selecting a new project. And we thought it would be beneficial to discuss with you the importance of selecting a good builder. What does it take to find the excellence needed to have a successful building or remodeling project? Right, Storm?
Oh, absolutely right, Rob. You know, selecting the right individual or company to work on your project is very important. So, Rob and I have put together some do's and don'ts, and then we're actually going to interview a couple of candidates.
First, absolutely first, make sure you have your plans together, that you have an idea where you're going with your project. Do you have those plans ready to make a good discussion with that builder?
And make sure you get referrals from reputable building supply companies.
Don't accept the lowest price. And make sure you have two or three competitive bids so you can compare builders' expenses and you know what you're getting into.
Check their references.
Is the builder a member of a professional society that has a set of ethical standards?
Make sure the builder carries adequate insurance.
Don't pay for everything up front. Make sure you have a schedule of payments, how much is due and when it is expected.
Yeah. Make sure you have a complete contract and read it carefully. A detailed description of all the work should be listed on that contract, including a breakdown of all labor and material costs and payment terms.
Please have an agreed upon start and stop date for your project.
And find out what they're going to do with all the debris and material once the project is finished.
Well, I think sort of that, that covers just about everything we wanted to talk about. And I think at this particular time, we want to start interviewing some builders and show you how important this is in planning your project. So will our first builder come in, please?
Hello.
Good morning, sir. And what's
Good morning.
Your name?
My name is Tom Perfect, but you could call me Mr. Perfect.
Great. Thanks, Mr. Perfect. Now, how long have you been a builder?
Well, I graduated from Harvard, and since that time, I put myself through school doing remodeling jobs on the side.
Hmm. Well, that's pretty impressive. Well, what kind of projects have you been working on?
Well, I handle only the best projects. The Trump Tower, the Sears Building, those just are a few of my accomplishments. I've done work for the Rothschilds and the Kennedys and the Rockefellers, of course. And I'm currently working on a 100-story building for Minneapolis and a 75-story building in Detroit. Now, that doesn't even count the 100 Wawas that I just finished building.
Hey, wow.
Well, okay. So, my goodness, you're a terribly busy builder, especially
yes,
with those Wawas. And what is your fee, and would you be interested in our project?
Well, I charge $10,000 just to schedule me, and I think I can fit it in my schedule somewhere along the line.
You know, Mr. Perfect, we really do appreciate you dropping by today and spending some time with us. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. Now, as long as it's by Monday, because I'm going to take a cruise and I'll be out of the country for 3 weeks.
Thank you.
Okay, well, that's one type of builder you might want to think twice about. Mm-hmm. Probably expensive, and scheduling certainly looks like it could be a problem. Okay, let's have our next applicant. And your name, sir?
Hi. I'm Tim. Tim Toolman. Not Tim the Toolman. That's a whole different guy. He deals with Al Wilson and Heidi. I loved Heidi. I loved Heidi. Tim Toolman.
Okay, I see you have a lot of tools.
I love my tools. They go everywhere with me. I take them everywhere. I adore them.
Okay, Tim. So how long have you been a builder?
Well, let's see. I started building sandcastles when I was 3, and then I moved up to Lincoln Logs and Legos.
Tim, we're talking about kind of real grown-up building projects.
Okay, that. Well, I started maybe 5 or 6.
5 or 6 years ago.
No, months ago. And it started after I decided to change careers.
Change your career from what?
Well, I used to be a shoe salesman. And then I moved into building. It got my foot in the door. And so I've done like 2 or 3 projects since then.
Okay, really, this is what we're trying to find out. What kind of projects?
Well, first I did a remodel on a basement. It was a very complicated job, and I really learned a lot.
Yeah. And since that project, what have you done?
Well, there was another job where I redid part of a house, and I did a room remodel. It took a lot out of me. But I really learned from it, and I believe I'm ready for some bigger and better things.
By the looks of it, you did learn from it. So those injuries, did they happen while you were on the job?
Well, yeah. And The good news is I didn't charge any of my customers for the damage that was done to me. And the doc says I'll be okay in about 3 weeks.
Okay. So let's just skip ahead a little bit. What is your fee?
Well, I would say for here in the church that you're looking at, about $1,000 would do it. And that $1,000 would at least allow me to keep my health benefits premium paid up.
Okay. Tim, we want to thank you for stopping by. We really appreciate you taking time out of your day.
I appreciate it, too. Thank you so much. I need to go lay down. My back is killing me.
You know, a chiropractor could help.
Nah, they're just a bunch of quacks anyway.
Yeah, so we've gone from Tom perfect to Tim not very perfect at all.
Folks, I think this really points out the importance of having these type of meetings before you start your project.
But you know, he reminds me of somebody in our congregation. I can't think who it is, but he reminds me. Well, anyway, we have one more builder. Let's meet him.
Welcome. And your name, sir?
My name is Jesus, and I'm a carpenter.
Okay.
All right, well, we have a few questions about your building experience.
Well, I've been a carpenter all my life. My father, he taught me everything I know.
But do you have a specialty?
Actually, I do. Churches. Churches are my specialty. I am an expert in reading their blueprints. I understand their foundation. I understand their structure. I have all the necessary tools. I have a crew of 12 that help me, and we put our heart and soul into building a church.
Wow. Sounds good. So, do you have a fee or a commission?
Well, you see, as my father taught me, and as I've taught my crew of 12, the most important foundation in life is the church. But it's not cheap to build a church. It takes money to build a church. Make it strong and safe for all who enter its doors. See, I charge the standard building fee for materials and my crew's labor, but my commission is building a church for the foundation of life, for our children and our families.
Well, I think that about ties it up. Storm and I would love to thank you for coming by today. And after the show, I'd like to meet you and your crew outside to talk more about our project.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. God bless.
Well, Rob, I think I speak for both of us when I say this was truly a special show, and I think we learned a lot.
Absolutely, Storm. I think what we demonstrated today, that a remodeling or a building project takes a lot of planning, a lot of time, there's money involved, and you really will reap the benefit of meeting with builders and spending some time with planning.
For sure.
But I think right now, Storm, I'd like to go outside and meet that Jesus fella and those other 12 people that he has working with.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do this.
Well, that was something. A little different. What an ensemble. She needs one. I've got one.
It's not on.
Oh, it's not on? No. What a performance.
Yes. Yes, and we have something to do with that performance. Today is October 8th.
This one's not working.
Is it? Okay. This is the day that we're going to have the kickoff for our Mobility Lift campaign. We will also entwine our campaign with our sesquicentennial celebration.
Sesquicentennial, can you spell that? Means 150 years. February of 1874 was the first time this congregation met. And by August 14th of that same year, they were officially recorded and incorporated. So we're going to celebrate our sesquicentennial in 2024.
That means that our church was incorporated in 1874. Wow, just think back.
Now, not this building. This building took 5 years to get built, but as a congregation. So you'll hear more about that as the year goes on.
Now, we have a few questions to ask of you. How easy is it to get to Fellowship Hall? Georgie.
So when was the last time any of you were down there?
Is there anyone here who has never been in Fellowship Hall
or doesn't even know what we're talking about? We're not talking about this room in the back. You got to get the name straight. That's the assembly room. Down all of those stairs is the Fellowship Hall and our big kitchen.
What kind of community events could we do if we had easy access to Fellowship Hall and the kitchen? If we had a mobility lift?
Or how easy would it be to get supplies down there when we're doing a big luncheon so we wouldn't have to lug trays up and down all those steps?
So, our campaign officially starts today. Our goal is to raise $100,000 this year, continually. We will end the campaign on August 14th, 2024, the day in 1874 that Calvary was incorporated.
And we have to say thank you to Jane, who was really the one that got the ball rolling on this. We've been talking about it for a long time, and she was the one who said, well, it's time to actually do something about it. She got us started looking at contractors, and also really was the one who convinced us that we can do this. So let me hold up the applause sign. Applause for Jane.
Session has approved that we proclaim 2024 our sesquicentennial year. We will celebrate our birthday all year long.
Shall I bring it up?
Okay, our fundraising goal is $100,000. In the mobility lift line item in the treasurer's report, there is now $2,500. We have a donor who will match all funds given up to $50,000 August 14th. This lift would be for young and old, anybody with mobility problems. So you can give in any way, you know, by checks, credit cards, stocks, estate planning. And Dorothy is holding up our gauge, made by Judy Sapezik. We will keep you informed as to how much has been given. And as you can see, this little elevator here, if you can see it moving up, it will move up as we get the money in. So we will keep this on display out in the narthex, and you will be able to see it whenever you come in, hopefully every week. And I think that's it for us. And we would like to wrap it up with our actors coming forward.
Or a curtain call. One more round of applause for the ensemble.
We'd like to wrap up this section with a prayer. If you'll pray with me. Dear Lord Jesus, our Savior, we come to you with hearts filled with gratitude for the abundant blessings you give us each day. We acknowledge
that cheerful giving is not an obligation, but a joyful act of worship. Help us understand that our giving is an expression of our deep love for you and our want to further your kingdom here on earth. Amen.
And now, a wonderful hymn, perfectly appropriate, you might say. How Firm a Foundation, number 612. Now, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God through him. And may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. May the peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.